Have you been praying? And you still have no answers.
Africa Inland Church, Melimani, Nairobi. We are a biblically mature community of believers worshiping and serving Jesus Christ. That things would have changed by now. We exist to glorify God by connecting people to Christ and His family, helping them to discover their life mission and positively impacting our world. It's done before. And remember, He can do it all once more. Guided by five biblical pillars, namely worship, ministry, evangelism, fellowship, and discipleship, we are dedicated to honor God in worship, sharing the good news of Christ, international discipleship and sound biblical teaching, as well as excellence in our service to God and humanity. Led by the Reverend Stephen Mairori, we have a team of seasoned and dedicated ministers, Reverend Matthew Okeo, Reverend Sylvester Kirwa, Pastor Rachel Kisula, Reverend Luke Odhiambo, Reverend Stephen Munyambu, and Reverend Hosea Mitei. We are anchored on the rock of ages and geared to the times to minister the love of Jesus Christ to a hurting global community. We are AIC Melimani Nairobi. We are dedicated to reach you online, on radio and on TV. Welcome to this online broadcast. The King bless you. It's like the brightest sunrise waiting on the other side.
Good evening, church, and praise the Lord. We want to thank Him for watching over us as we welcome you to this Wednesday midweek service. We thank the Lord for protecting us and bringing us here. So I want us to begin with a word of prayer. So I invite all of us now to bow down for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful. We thank you because you are our Lord. We worship and adore you because you are the King of our hearts. You have watched over us. You have given us life. You have continued to protect us and provide for us, even in these difficult moments. And we even thank you for the opportunity of fellowshipping together through this online platform. We don't take it for granted. We thank you for that special grace. And we pray even as we begin that, Lord, you will speak to us. We will hear your voice, and that, Lord, whatever we will do will be pleasing in your eyes. So we pray that you may be with us, even as we invite your presence, that you may go with us this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now I want to invite praise and worship team to lead us in a hymn. And after the hymn, we will have the senior pastor take us from there. Karibuni, praise and worship team.
We want to make this prayer together with you. I think it is the best prayer that anyone can make. Nataka nikujue Yesu. I wish tungeweza kubadilisha hii badala nimjue nikujue yeye Yesu zaidi na zaidi nikufahamu. Thank you Jesus. Zaidi za idi zaidi nikufahamu. Ni kufahamu Yesu, nijue pendo lake na wokovu wake kamili. Nataka nimjue Yesu na nizidi kumfahamu, nijue pendo lake na wokovu wake kamili. Zaidi, zaidi nimfahamu Yesu, nijue pendo lake na
nataka nione Yesu na nizidi kusikia anenapo kitabuni kujidhihirisha kwangu. Imba zaidi
zaidi zaidi
tena zaidi
nimfahamu Yesu
nijue
nijue pendo lake na wokovu wake kamili.
Nataka nimfahamu
na nizidi kupambanua mapenzi yake nipone yale yanayompendeza.
Ombi langu zaidi
zaidi nimfahamu Yesu nijue pendo lake na wokovu wake kamili.
Nataka nikae nae
kwa mazungumzo zaidi nizidi kuwaonyesha wengine wokovu.
That you may be revealed to us, that you will reveal yourself to us, that we will know you more, more and more, knowing about you, having an experience with you, for the glory and honor of your name. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening, church. Very glad to join you this evening on our Wednesday service. And thank you for making time to be part of this worship. We're continuing with our series of dealing with the negative impact of COVID-19. Last week, we were blessed to be joined by two of our members to discuss the issues of mental health and also stress. Today, I'm very honored to be joined by the Reverend Kirwa to discuss on the spiritual impact of this. As we go through this season, particularly with the COVID-19, we know there are questions that touch on our spiritual life, and we'll be digging deep to understand. Reverend, we are living in unprecedented times. The economists of international repute have warned of even major recessions. When you look at the health sector, it is stretched, you know, to the maximum or to the end. The skies are silent. The sporting stadium, which you are part of, you know, you are a games person. Yeah, all the sports, you know, stadiums are just, you know, not being used. So a lot of things have come to a stop. The world, I should say, is shaken. And yet, when you look at scriptures, this is not new. Times that are difficult have come. And so today, would love for you to help us, particularly from a spiritual perspective, so that we can know how to respond during such times. So today we'll be looking at lessons learned from the exile. And before we look at the lessons, probably it would be good first for you to explain to us what was this exile period, and you know, when did it happen, and what was it about?
Thank you, Reverend Mairori, our senior pastor. I want to thank you for giving an opportunity to me, especially on such a very delicate period, to discuss the exile experience, especially relating to Christianity today. We, as you said rightly, is that we are in a crisis, a spiritual kind of crisis. Why a spiritual kind of crisis? Because to us, the norm is no more. What we were used to is no more. And just to answer your question to begin with, is that we are talking of an exile period between 598 to 538, close to 70 years that the children of Israel were out of their comfort zone in an exile under the Babylonian captivity. Thank you.
So, some similarities. During that time, you know, they used to be in Jerusalem. Now the temple is no more. They have been taken to captivity.
Yeah.
So several things change.
Yes.
The normal that they were used to is no more. Mm-hmm. Normal, very, very, very similar to us right now when we're actually thinking, okay, we can't go to church on Sunday.
Yes.
It's a very different time. Would you talk to us, probably share with us the lessons that were learned during that time when they were away from their home,
yes,
when they were in exile? What key lessons were learned? Because I think those are very important lessons for us today.
Thank you, Reverend. That's a broad question, yes, but we can pick on a few lessons that were learned by the Israelites while they were away from home. And one of them is that, remember, as you said, they left the temple and went to a new place.
Yep.
They left their city. They were used to Jerusalem. They had the comfort of going to the temple. There were rituals that were in the temple. They are no more. There is a city they were used to, Jerusalem. There was business as usual. There was everything. The social life was there. It is no more. So all these had to change when they went to exile, and they had to find a new way of worshiping.
Wow.
Yeah.
So how did it work for them when they reached there? How did they establish their new normal? And what lessons did they pick while they were there?
The scriptures are essentially very forthcoming in terms of what they were ordered to do, or they were instructed to do.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things is that, remember, we are talking of the children of Israel, a people who have a history. They have a history from the time they came out of the Exodus. You remember the Exodus experience?
Yes.
So Moses had this covenant that was submitted to the children of Israel. There was an agreement between the children of Israel and God. There were things that they were supposed to do, and there were things they were not supposed to do. And there were consequences for things that they did which were not supposed to be done. And there were also fruits for things they did that were supposed to be done in the covenant. And so that history informs what is going to happen to them while in exile.
Now, actually, you've helped me before probably we look at the lessons learned.
Mm-hmm.
It begs the question, what caused the exile?
Uh-huh.
Because these people were in their home, but something really happened that caused them to go to exile.
To exile.
Wow. What was it from a biblical perspective?
From a biblical perspective,
yes.
One of the key issues that raised or occasioned the movement to exile as a punishment, remember, was idolatry.
All right.
They forgot that they had a relationship with God. and they began, they were influenced by their neighbors. You see, idolatry was one. Two, there were issues to do with corruption. There were issues to do with false prophets. There were issues to do with what else?
Probably injustice.
Injustice to the poor. All those who are named. And remember, we are putting the Ten Commandments are here vis-a-vis what they are doing against these Ten Commandments. And so that reality sends them away to exile.
So they broke their covenant.
With God.
With God.
Yeah. In fact, that's the right word. They broke their covenant with God.
And so God decides to punish them.
That he had to bring them out of this comfort zone and take them out so that they can see the sense of their relationship with God.
Must have been very difficult being in a foreign land. You have no freedom, but here you are, mm-hmm. a child of God or somebody who should be worshiping God in the temple. You are not able to do that. Now, take us quickly, probably if you can, through while they were there, what lessons were learned?
Now, there are very theological, positive impact that the children of Israel learned from exile. One of the things is the development they had very good, you know, the temple is no more. So what happens? They have to find a way of worshiping and a place. We see the establishment of the synagogue. And that is carried all along to the New Testament.
Right.
Because, you know, remember, the law says there are people who are not supposed to get into the temple. Mm-hmm. And now, this brings us to the second point. Since there is the establishment of the synagogue, it tells you there is evangelism. They have to bring in these Gentiles, these people who do not know God, you see. So there is the synagogue. There is the evangelism that is coming in. Obviously, when you begin to evangelize, you need literature. So they had to develop literature. Yes, Reverend.
Worship style changed, really. How they worshipped God was never the same.
Yeah.
But there were some good things that happened, which brought in inclusion of others into worship.
Yes. And there's one more thing that came in, you know, in the temple, they were used to rituals. There are things that are done this way. This you are supposed to come up to here. You are supposed to pray like that.
Yes.
But now, while they are in exile, something new comes up. Mm-hmm. Their prayer life mm-hmm. changes.
Wow.
They move from rituals to speaking to God. That is prayer life. That's a positive.
So they now stopped depending on just the ritual part of the worship. They now had a personal relationship in
with
the
God.
Sense of reaching out to God.
With God.
What are the lessons?
You see, they now begin to depend solely on God. Their dependence on God comes to occasion. They reawaken their life into knowing who this God is. Yep. They rekindle their faith. You see, while they were at home, things were normal. There were the prophets saying, stop this, we don't want this, we don't want this. But now they are away.
Yeah.
What happens? Their faith is rekindled.
So there's revival.
There's revival.
So it takes a crisis sometimes to help us think through our relationship with God.
Yes.
And so while they were there, they realized what was the prophets were saying, we've always taken for granted. Mm-hmm. Now we are in a difficult place. They now had no choice. If I can use that word. Mm-hmm. They now, those who really knew God said, now we lost God, we need to go back to him. So there's revival.
There's restoration.
Yes.
There's a sense of trying to come back.
Yes.
There's a sense of trying to revive that which had died.
Yes.
And you see, the prophets that were there then, yep. they are those who went with them to exile.
Yes.
Like Jeremiah.
Yes.
And from them, You know, they had a history. This is what we lost. This is what we lost. Like now, the period we are in today, we wouldn't be doing what we are doing today. It's because of where we are, the situation, the crisis we are in. And so it has changed everything. The same thing applies to these children of Israel in exile. Their form of worship changed. Their standard, their public moral standards changed. You see?
So spiritually they were reawakened and connected to God. Any other things that they learned, we can learn from that period?
It is important to, first of all, realize that religion to them was no longer an outward issue. You know, they were used to 3 o'clock prayers. They were used to maybe 9 o'clock prayers. It was an outward show. Now, there's no temple. What happens? It changes to an inward show. There's a reflection of personal relationship with God. Yeah, and not communion.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Excellent. That is amazing. Currently, with where we are, I know the comparison may be, you know, again, this is not a temple, but it's a place we all come. The church is a place we all come. We haven't been here for, you know, a few months, a month and something. And it's changed. It's changed. Now we've gone to pray in our homes. For those who were not able to lead family worship, we are now leading family worship. I should say people are now beginning to up their game in terms of their own personal commitment to God. Because you're not meeting your pastor every Sunday. You can see them really on the screen. But the challenge is on you to grow your spiritual life. Anything else you want to say from the exile so that we move on to the next thing?
I think the exile experience, according to me, is one, we begin to experience God differently.
Okay, that's one.
Secondly, our personal relationship with God is enhanced.
Okay.
Thirdly, just to wrap up the issue of the family, remember, I can give you my own example. The last time I had my family, all of them in one place for 2 months, I can't remember. But now for 2 months, they are there. I am now the spiritual father. And their mother maybe is a pastor. Now that has changed everything. You see? Now we are moving towards one, the families are now getting to a level of accepting the situation. Now, what do we do about it? Let's come together. Let's have hope. Such things were not there. It's a new experience. Maybe thirdly, there's development of a kind of new theology. Now we begin to ask, okay, like now church, we are being asked, please, would you send your tithe through this line? Would you please get reference, like the way we do in AIC Milimani, every day there is a scripture for me to read from home. Now there is the personal initiative coming in relationship to knowing God.
One of the things that when you read through, you see as the prophets spoke about hope that is coming, it gave people to realize that while we had sinned, we have been punished by God, but God is a God of hope. Would you like to shed some light there?
Let's get back to our reference topic, exile experience. What does God do? One of the things that God does, he raises up a man, Cyrus. And Cyrus shapes the thinking. What is this that we are looking forward to? You see? And I like the just before we came to this show, there were discussions between me and you. You highlighting the few things that you think we can do better. Why? Because of the current crisis. Usually, when there is a crisis, there is a tendency to find a new way of doing things.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, I will transition because of time. Now that we are where we are, definitely this is, for us, it's not an exile experience, but we can learn some lessons. and hopefully and pray that this will draw us closer to God. One of the things that we realize that causes exile is when people become complacent with God. And sometimes coming to church every Sunday, people just become complacent and they are not taking their own personal spiritual life very, very, very seriously. While this is not an exile experience, some people are going through a very difficult time, just like those who went to exile are going through a very difficult time. Mm-hmm. Some people have lost their jobs. Some people have actually are not able to pay rent, and they are going through a very difficult time. What would you say is a hope from your experience on looking at the exile? Does God just leave people that way, or there is hope?
Reverend, there is hope.
Yes.
While we were doing an introduction to this topic, we learned that while they were in exile, a new idea came in. How do we involve these hosts per se? How do we get them into our religion? The same thing is, or can be similar to what we are going through now. You see, as a church, it's only the other day in this very church that I learned the leadership of Love Inc. belonged to this church. Some of them are here with us every Sunday.
Yeah, right.
But I've never taken the initiative to know what Love Inc. is.
Yeah, right.
You see what is coming out?
Yes.
Realities of life. And as you are saying, there are those of us who are not... There is a negative impact to them. One, losing their jobs, as you say.
Yes.
What then should we do? The Bible is clear. The last commandment and the final one is love. When I have this and can be shared out to somebody else, that should be the trend in the church now. What do we do about those of us who do not have?
Yeah.
What do we do about those? That's a kind of evangelism. We will be bringing them closer to God even as we share what we have.
So really, your call for us is, it's now time to practice our faith.
Yes.
By those Action. Who are able to assist.
Yes.
Those who are not able. And carry each other through this difficult time.
Very true.
And of course, we will ask the clergy pray for the people that God would help them through this difficult time. Mm-hmm. There's a covenant relationship that I've mentioned here in church a few times. Mm-hmm. And I've actually been thinking through. When you looked at part of the things that caused the exile was idolatry, breaking of covenants, mm-hmm. And one of them actually had to do with serving the interests of other courts, not using our resources to serve God.
Yes.
What did you say about that?
You see, it's a very valid question that, you know, God has called us to be stewards. That's the first thing. Mm-hmm. Whatever that is in your hands is God-given. What I have is God-given. Mm-hmm. And as a steward, as you quote one of the scriptures in Malachi, chapter 3, I think 18,
yeah, right.
We are supposed to give back. There is a relationship, there is a covenant between me and God that when I have, for example, 10 pieces of water,
yes.
5 liters or whatever, then one of them is supposed to go back to
God. Yes.
As a response to what he has done to me, you see? So one is taken out. Why? It is not going to waste. Yeah. There are different programs in the church so that our giving, whether it is tithe, whether it is a love offering, whether it is sadaka, the normal offerings, there is a program. That is,
it will go to.
Yes.
So what you are saying really is God has a mission, and that mission will be achieved through his covenant people.
Correct.
And now it's the church.
Yes.
So you are basically telling us if God has covenanted with you, just like you do with the government, you don't even feel when the 25% goes or 30%.
I've not even never seen somebody complain.
So 10% is always for God and for his mission.
Yes,
when you
true.
Break that, It grieves God. What are some of the idols that we probably today, those days, idolatry was very clear. What are some of the idols so that we don't fall into the same
The contemporary problem? Idols, one, Reverend, is pleasure.
Pleasure
is one.
Okay.
Secondly, wealth.
Okay.
You know, wealth seems to occupy the space of God in our lives.
Okay.
You get moved to achieve one, you move to the next, you move to the next.
So in other words, anything that comes in between you
and God,
that can break our covenant.
Our relationship with God.
So we need to learn that. Mm. So church, we are so grateful. Thank you so much, Reverend Gilbert. This is a subject that would have continued, but because of time, I want to thank you for joining us. We learn from what the scriptures teach us so that we don't repeat the same mistakes. We are where we are as a country, but we have hope. God is with us. We have hope because as a church, we are one, we are together. We can reach out and help each other. My prayer is if you see a brother or sister going through a difficult time, you reach out in the name of Christ, and Christ will bless you. So thank you for joining us. And I want to wish you God's blessing even as we continue with this discussion. Next week, we'll look at financial planning, particularly looking at the impact that in the global economy and how we can plan ourselves as God helps us. Thank you very much, and may the Lord bless you.
Thank you. We want to thank God so much because of the conversation that is indeed enlightening. And we thank God because of what he's doing. And so for now, we want to go to the Lord in prayer. Please allow me to read 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. And this is what the word of God says. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of him. So this is the confidence that is we are approaching the prayer with, that there's a God who hears. So let's pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you because of your word that has assured us and promised us that you hear us. And even God, this moment in our time and in our exiles, in our loneliness, we know that there is a God in heaven who hears us when we approach him in prayer. And so, Father, we want to pray that, Lord, you may hear us, hear the cries of our families, hear the cries of the body of Christ, the church, hear the cries, O God of glory, of the nations all over the world, hear the cries that people are having at individual level, because you hear your people. So we thank you because of your majesty. We thank you because of the great things that you do. You are the God who created everything that is, and we know that, Lord, in everything, Father, Lord, you are still sovereign. So we pray that, Lord, you may minister to us. You know our hearts. You know the hearts that have been broken. You know spirits that have been crushed. You know the wounds that people are having. And I want to pray in the name of Jesus that, my God and my Father, you may fill these for your purposes, O God of glory, and for your glory in the lives of your children. So we thank you, God, even right now, in our season of distress, in our seasons of sicknesses, we pray that you who changes not, you will indeed be our guide and our shield. We bless your holy name right now. We pray for our members of the congregation and beyond, those who are having different challenges of life, that my Father and my God, you may minister to them. And we also pray that you reveal yourself strong to them who do not know you, so that, Lord, they will come to a realization and be obedient to the call of salvation. Lord, we want to thank you because of the many people who are in the front line, that my God and my Father, you may protect them, keep them, shield them. And above all, we pray that you may be with them in every way, so that, Lord of glory, they will not be depressed or stressed. You are going to indeed protect their lives, O God. Also be their provider, even as you shield them. So, Lord, we want to thank you. We thank you because of those who maybe have lost hope because of their jobs. They have lost their jobs. Those who do not have money, they don't even know what they are going to eat next. I want to pray because you hear us, God who provides, Jehovah Jireh is your name, the Lord God, you may provide for them. So God, I pray for peace, and I pray for your goodness, and I pray for your mercies. Minister to us and build us in you. In the name of Jesus, we pray and we give thanks. Amen. Church, we are grateful for another opportunity that God has given to us so that we can give to the work of God. And we will be giving through the pay bill number 809-109. Please write the account if it is a tithe, if it is an offering, or it is a thanksgiving, or any other giving that you want to give to the church. So may God bless you even as you tap through the blessings of stewardship.
Atonement for sin and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done.
Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives.
Praise the Lord,
praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, and the people rejoice. Oh God, to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done. Rejoicing through Jesus the Son, but purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our worship when Jesus we see.
Thank you so much, Church, for joining us this evening for our service. It has been a blessing. And now we want to commit ourselves before the Lord for the week, even as we say the grace. So you can join me in saying the grace together as we bring this service to a close. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. God bless you and see you on Sunday. Thank you.